Hello, everyone, and welcome to NEMO's webinar, Audience at the Center, Development Strategies and Organizational Change. My name is Elizabeth, and I work for NEMO. As the network for museums in Europe, our main activities include advocating for museums at the EU level, providing training opportunities, providing a platform for museums to exchange and then learn from each other, and helping museums to cooperate across borders. We are looking forward to today's webinar, facilitated by Adeste Plus. We will be hearing from Alessandra Garibaldi, head of the transnational projects of the Fondazione Fitzcarraldo, Inesh Kamara, founder, CEO, and creative and special projects manager at the Mapa das Ideas, and Susana Gomez da Silva, head of education at the Modern Art Center of the Calouste Gulbenkian Foundation. The NEMO webinar will present a hands-on methodology for creating, prototyping, and testing audience development strategies and implementing organizational change. The methodology, audience-centered experience design, has been developed since 2016 by the Adeste Plus project and strives to reach the real people behind hard data, replacing abstract data points with tangible connections. At the end of the session, you will have the opportunity to ask questions using the chat function, or if you'd like, you can come on screen and ask your questions live. Please note that the entire session and conversation following will be recorded. So without further ado, I'm going to hand this over to our speakers to get started.
Thank you, Liz, and good morning, everybody. I am Alessandra Garibaldi, and I will introduce you in the first 10 minutes, let's say, the frame of the Adeste Plus project. And then Inesh Kamara will follow with going a little bit more in depth with the methodology. And Susana Gomez da Silva will help you see how it actually works in a real museum context. So thank you very much to NEMO for organizing this webinar. This belongs to a series of webinars that we are running across Europe to disseminate and discuss what are our achievements so far towards the end of the project. So I will share with you a presentation. So we are 15 partners, and the partnership of this project is composed by, articulated, let's say, in different levels, which is for us very important because we try to match research partners, artistic partners, such as Gulbenkian Foundation and many others, and policy partners, considering that somehow tackling the issue of cultural participation might be different from different perspectives. And we did want to somehow enable cultural institutions and museums and theaters and libraries to somehow being able to deliver that side of the story, which is audience development. So cultural participation is a major challenge, much bigger than every cultural institution, but we all have a role to play in it, and museums have a major role in this. This is not a specific tool for museums, but it has been tested, especially in the second round, let's say, of tests we did, not only with artistic partners, also with many museums, because we wanted this to be a way for all to somehow reflect and find new practices towards audience development. So the project is mainly about, you might have seen this video, but is mainly about creating a methodology to try to help cultural institutions. And it's a quite easy methodology in a way. So it's based on design thinking, is a series of workshops run within the cultural institutions with the staff, a transversal group of staff. So to cross-cut the different sectors that usually don't work together within institutions. And we, through this model, we tested with them, we refined the model, and then we tested it again in other countries with other cultural institutions, dozens. And then we now have what we call a blueprint. So basically a process that will be made available for all the world, not just Europe, so that other cultural institutions can get inspiration and see how can this could look like. So let's say the principle that I would like to introduce in the very beginning is that in our understanding, audience development is not a technical issue, not just a technical issue. It's a matter of value, of principles, of way of behaving. And especially it's not about developing audiences, but mainly about developing cultural organizations. Meaning that if we failed up to now into the endeavor, it's not an undertaking, but an endeavor of enlarging cultural participation across Europe in a more diverse, deep and engaged relationship with citizens, it's also because we are not all equipped, not at the moment. And although we do many amazing projects in cultural participation, particularly museum education in this is a very long story, we didn't achieve with, and data told us, that kind of participation. And this is because there is something we need to change within ourselves as cultural organizations before we can somehow dream to change something outside for citizens. So we started from the principles that audience development, effective, let's say, audience development, meaning a long-lasting one that really changes relationships between organizations and citizens, but also a lasting one that becomes sustainable, are, let's say, few barriers that we tried to somehow overcome or address through the principles that we use for designing our project. The first is that usually audience development is an activity demanded to educators, marketers, communication managers at some point of the production chain somehow. They are sometimes amazing, but they are often, most of the time, let's say, tackled as if they were an add-on to the activity. It's the last mile, it's never embedded into the design of the programming, of displaying, of communication and everything. So what we did is that we considered that it was not about empowering single participants or single members of the staff in doing amazing things that end up usually to be very aside compared to the, let's say, full activity and structural activity of the organization, but to empower change makers throughout the organizations. So in the process, we basically choose to work with and groups of members of the staff. There was one change maker, let's say, in charge of leading the others and supporting, let's say, leading the process. But all the participants, that is communication manager, marketing managers, visitor experience manager, programmers, curators, artistic directors, they were all change makers. And this because it has to be a shared responsibility. And this leads to the second point, that it's silos practices. Those amazing projects usually have the problem that they start and end. So at the end of the project and at the end of the budget, also the relationship with the audience somehow get weaker or disappear. Or alongside these, silos practices are those for which, especially in big institutions, but also in medium and small-sized organizations, are silos practices. So there, my work in the exhibition as exhibition manager ends here, my work as educator starts here. So usually those groups don't work together. I mean, this sometimes happens, but not very often, not as often as we would like. So the teams we were working with were as much diverse as possible, technicians, all you can imagine. The third reason for which audience development processes are not successful as hoped or expected is that often they are based on stereotypes. We are all terribly biased by stereotypes, and data sometimes don't help because they are useful, absolutely necessary, good cementation is needed, but it's not enough. So going beyond real data to get to real people and getting in touch with that feeling that is the real people needs and diversity is something that can be developed only through empathy. And this through the process is what we try to do, not just for educators, because they are already empathetic, even too much, but also with technicians, with marketing managers, with other people within the organization that usually don't have this feeling of for whom and who are the ones they are working for. We are almost at the end. Another issue we see is that we are often, as organization, let's say self-sustaining, self-maintaining, we are very risk adverse as institutions. So we might have someone more with more risk attitude, but as an organization, we are usually very scared of taking risks. So the use of design thinking in this is great also because it helps prototyping and failing fast and failing and going for iterations that makes risk somehow more acceptable. And the last is, of course, the fear of losing control. We don't have a recipe for this, but the big issue is where is up to what point we are going to allow people in giving their voices, hearing their voices into the interpretation, also of our collections. This is not easy at all. And it's not, I mean, there's no one solution. But anyway, it's a discussion we must have. And throughout the process, we tried, and also through the other activities of the project, we tried to open up this kind of conversation because it's really important to have this conversation. Otherwise, we will be always working on the surface of technicalities somehow. If we don't accept and don't discuss and debate within the organization about what's the role of audiences, how much power are we going to give up, how much space we are actually giving to listen without giving up our role, our mission as institutions. So our challenge was to develop a methodology for transformative audience-focused work, considering that we didn't just want to give means to design good experiences for audiences, but also through this process to change the way cultural organizations were working internally and perceiving their role, coming to the idea of cultural participation. So we did what we call a blueprint, and the milestones were prototyping the methodology, testing it with 6 cultural organizations across Europe, among which there was Kalustu Gulbenkian, then refine and test with other institutions, and then organizing summer schools and conferences. And this is also the chance for us for inviting you to our final conference. I know that some NEMO members also subscribe to the summer school. I'm very happy about that, and we are very glad. And also the conference will be open anyway. There will be no selection. It will be also online for those who would not be able to attend it in Turin next November. And that will be the moment in which we will try really to open up and discuss, so what? That's a tool, just like many European projects are developing around with other means and approaches, but this is our contribution. So I think that that conference will be really a very interesting time to discuss about different approaches to promote cultural participation, which are somehow transformative for cultural institutions. And so I leave the floor to Ines for the next part of the presentation. Thank you.
So, hi, good morning. I'm so happy to be with you here. So, Alessandra has made the big introduction, and as you can see, it's a very ambitious project because basically the idea is to open up cultural organization and promote change within by learning with the audiences. And the project had this huge journey until this moment that's focused on consolidating the methodology and trying it out to see how it works in different organizational settings. And we're talking about sectorial settings, so going from theaters to museums, but also from the size point of view. So we really wanted to understand if this worked in big organizations, but also in smaller organizations, and what would be the challenges about that. So the first thing that we have to know about our framework, so to speak, about the methodology, is that it's based on change and it's based on the 3-step model from Lewin. And what we want to do is to trust the methodology. So that's the first challenge is to trust the process, even when it seems that it's not going to work. We also aim for a very transparent, a very practical approach. Hence, we are going to launch the blueprint online until the end of the year. And it will be like an open source methodology. And the first thing is to do is that we know that we have to go for unfreezing, we have to move, and then we have to refreeze. So in the process, what we're talking about is going from a jump from what is the status quo and our pre-assumptions to a moment that we think together as a collective intelligence. And then we go and we try to freeze what we've decided into a prototype that can be, that is doable. So when we went for the design thinking paradigm, we were looking for that kind of approach. And basically we're going to go from moments where we are favoring divergent practices and thoughts to convergent. And the process, as we call it, as a double diamond, just goes to open it up, have a very fruitful and a very direct discussion about what we're thinking about, and then we just close to get conclusions, and then we'll open again, and then we'll close. One of the big important parts about the YAST cycle is that it involves people with different characteristics and profiles and different types of knowledge within the organization. And that's one of the main issues of the process. So in all these Adeste Plus workshops, from the artistic partners and research partners to the extended, to the waterfall programs, we really tried to bring diversity from the organization inside the room. And the first step would be to work for Yin Freeze, to build up this team, this small revolutionary cell within the organization. Then to try to work upon empathizing and overcoming what Alison was describing as the stereotypes that we have towards what we do and towards our audiences, then define a problem, then ideate and put out there all kinds of different ideas and concepts and really go above and then prototype and try to get a feasible project. So these are basically the steps from Adeste that end with the embedding of the prototype in the organization. And that's the magic, so to speak, of opening up the organization to the audiences and also promoting internal change. So here you can see that we go from preparing, aligning the team, to at the end, to do the process of embedding. From our experience, in all these different workshops and processes, it was so interesting because the target audiences that we were usually discussing in the preparation meetings was not the target audience that was defined within this revolutionary cell of the organization. So we really felt that there is a difference, there is a change when we join people that come from very different departments and also from hierarchical levels in the organizations that bring in this kind of definition and bring in new people, so to speak. So that leads to what we were talking about, this idea of a surprise, this idea of really trusting the process and really embracing the all the surprises and all the changes that it can bring in. It demands preparatory work, of course, because you really have to have everybody aligned for the project. And that is work. You can't just get into a room and just say, let's do this now. You have to explain the process to the people and you have to build up this team. But it's already, it's a very creative process. And that's also sometimes a challenge for our organizations because people, in spite of working in cultural organizations, sometimes they feel that they have these barriers to any kind of experimentation, taking risks and being creative. And that's also part of the preparatory work. And this idea of the double diamond scheme, where you're always dividing the work between divergent and convergent phases, really puts people in the right mood, so to speak. And then it's all about this idea of prototyping. And really what we would wish for would be for any organization, cultural or otherwise, to be able to develop themselves in these micro or macro prototypes that would be enablers of change and work. So next for the Adeste project, what we're doing this year is that we're spreading the knowledge, spreading our mantra. We've really tested the methodology and we know that it really works. And our extended waterfall program, as Alessandro described, between the summer school, the European conferences, and the policy forums, really have to do with this dissemination of the methodology, but also of the project values, of what we all share. And we really feel that over these terrible last 18 months of the pandemics, it's really important for us to refocus on the audiences, refocus on our relationship with our publics, with our visitors, to explore the new channels that we opened with the pandemic's crisis, because we're talking now about this mix of digital audiences with people that come into our doors in the museums. And we're also talking about this approach that has to do with serving our mission, serving cultural democracy, but also having a very strong marketing, practical, managerial approach. And we really think that this will be the right pathway for the projects. And we hope to see you again soon. You can see more about our work at the Adeste Plus website. And now I'm going to pass the word to Susanna, that's going to talk about the prototype that was developed according to this methodology by the Carlos Gulbenkian Foundation, our artistic partner in Portugal. And it was really, I'm really happy to be with you today to put Susanna into the circle, because Mapa das Ideias and Carlos Gulbenkian Foundation were the Portuguese partners, are the Portuguese partners of the project, and it's been this terrific and very, very interesting journey. Susanna, I'm just going to pass it on to you.
Hi, everyone. It's really wonderful to be here. And as Inês said, we were the partners, the Portuguese partners of Adeste, and it was really a great journey. So what I would like to start by doing is by presenting a short video that will highlight the whole process. So as you've been following, just before the video, as we've been following, we created a prototype, and I'm here representing not only the Carlos Foundation, but a whole team of change makers. So as Alessandra presented, we tried to make the teams working within the institution as wider and diverse possible. And so just please note that this video is the result of a prototype created by different departments inside of the organization working together. So the music department, the museum, and the Carlos Gulbenkian Museum, and the gardens, which has also an audience development plan. So please enjoy the video and then I'll get back to you.
Somos programadores imaginários, programadores contadores de histórias e histórias. Trabalhamos em ecossistemas de partilhas, de pensamento crítico, de transformações e mudanças. Queremos propor uma interseccionalidade em rizoma e desenvolver uma casa comum.
Imagina, na verdade, o Gulbenkian 1525 Imagina é um projeto experimental. No fundo, é uma espécie de laboratório que nos permite trabalhar com públicos jovens, pensando sobre o que é programar para e com públicos jovens. o Imagina, no fundo, proporciona o espaço onde esta experiência se pode dar. Reunimos um conjunto de jovens por open call, com quem debatemos o que é a programação, o que é que as instituições como a Gulbenkian deveriam programar e o que é que eles frequentam enquanto utilizadores, não é, de instituições e de programação. E depois demos-lhes a oportunidade de pensar connosco o que é que seria programar do ponto de vista deles e propor alguns eventos que fossem da sua lavra.
É um projeto que traz um grupo de jovens que foram convidados a vir pensar em programação, sobretudo programação para as suas faixas etárias, e a programar connosco os vários serviços educativos da Fundação, portanto, o Serviço Educativo da Música, o Serviço Educativo do Jardim e o Serviço Educativo do Museu, e envolvendo também outras unidades orgânicas como a comunicação e o marketing.
O Imagina 1525 realmente propôs-se a deixar-nos fazer isso, a ouvir-nos, a perceber quais é que eram as nossas preocupações, quais é que eram as nossas prioridades em termos de, não só de programação, mas também de conversas atuais, e realmente deu-nos espaço para trabalharmos isso.
Artistas de jazz, que por si só é uma música historicamente de intervenção.
São Bárbara Streisand, que era uma compositora do Rio
de recuperar essas origens e essas raízes destas subculturas.
Fazer o cruzamento com aquilo que já é, sim, a programação da Fundação, também dá força na vossa programação.
Estivemos em contato com pessoas que a trouxeram a dar talks e conversas, pessoas do meio artístico, programadores. Isso foi incrível, poder termos a oportunidade de falar com elas, de saber como foi o seu percurso, tudo aquilo que eles nos mostraram de como funciona na vida real, sempre ter essa ideia idealizada de como é que é, que depois quebrou de alguma forma.
Uma coisa que me surpreendeu de uma forma muito agradável e muito positiva foi o facto de ter a percepção de que estes jovens veem na programação uma ferramenta para falar das preocupações do dia-a-dia, daquilo que é a realidade dos dias de hoje, daquilo que é discutido todos os dias, ou seja, de uma coisa muito atual.
E se nós habitamos todos este ecossistema, porque é que há certas histórias que nunca se ouvem? Depois, a partir daí, foi pensar também tudo o que estava a acontecer no mundo, quais é que eram os temas que nós achávamos pertinentes e começar a desenhar o programa assim, de acordo com isso.
Ah, não, isso é muito sério. Então, tipo, às 8.
Às 8.
Então, isto é domingo.
Este conjunto de ideias de programação que eles trouxeram nesse nosso encontro era um conjunto muito, muito extenso de ideias. Muitas ideias eram bastante interessantes. Estava muito presente a temática das sexualidades dissidentes, as questões coloniais, questões também relacionadas com o racismo e por aí fora, e havia já ideias sobre como formalizar estas propostas. Seria não só cruzar estas ideias com aquilo que é o ADN da própria Fundação, como trabalhar com os vários serviços educativos, realmente como é que elas poderiam concretizar em termos programáticos.
Depois, o facto de nós reunirmos, falarmos, ver as ligações que temos em comum, todas as ideias que de pessoas tão diferentes, porque isso foi interessante também, pessoas de backgrounds completamente diferentes, ver que é o que temos em comum e há muitas coisas em comum mesmo.
Quando a pandemia veio e as coisas ficaram meio estagnadas,
O que aconteceu é que muitas vezes eu percebia que a batata quente não estava só nas nossas mãos. Eu pensava assim, ah, nós os jovens é que estamos perdidos, mas eles vão nos direcionar tudo, mas na verdade estávamos todos no mesmo barco.
Quando se deu a ruptura, não é, no projeto, por causa da pandemia, nós tivemos a oportunidade, não é, de programar, tentar programar algo para o público e no digital. Mas nós, enquanto grupo, decidimos aproveitar esse tempo para uma pausa e para aprofundar uma série de reflexões. E nós achámos que isso em si era um ato de resistência, desde logo porque na sociedade que nós vivemos hoje em dia, eu acho que parar um bocadinho para pensar e aprofundar temas e refletir é em si só intrinsecamente um ato de resistência, não é? E termos a oportunidade de ir a criar um ciclo de conversas, a falar com uma série de artistas e investigadores ligados às áreas dos temas que nós já tínhamos estado a debater e que vimos que com a pandemia só se tornaram ainda mais urgentes, foi uma oportunidade de ouro para esse pensamento.
Mas, entretanto, tínhamos que continuar com o projeto, tínhamos que fazer alguma coisa. O que aconteceu foi uma segunda programação, que foi um começo, na verdade, que foi tudo ligado ao digital, tudo virtualmente, mas, entretanto, conseguimos adaptar o que já tínhamos, várias coisas que já tínhamos preparado a essa nova situação do online. Desenvolvemos conversas, nos reorganizamos em grupos, desfizemos os grupos, voltamos a fazer. Foi muita discussão, muita conversação e, entretanto, conseguimos.
Vê-los projetar, assentar ideias, falar com os artistas, convidar e pôr tudo em processo foi muito interessante. E foi realmente, para mim, o momento mais importante do projeto até agora.
Das coisas que eu aprendi e daquilo que eu mais gostei deste processo foi o diálogo com as outras pessoas e com as outras ideias, perceber que há temas que eu já conheço mas que não sei tanto sobre eles ou que há outras perspectivas sobre o mesmo tema que eu não conhecia.
O nosso grupo, o Imagina, está a deixar muito óbvio a necessidade que as instituições terem que mudar. Terem que ser mais disponíveis, terem que ser mais acessíveis e terem que abordar assuntos sem terem medo de serem alvo de críticas.
E fica realmente esta porta que se abriu e que pode encostar, mas não volta a fechar. Portanto, esta porta de comunicação com o mundo que está lá fora, da auscultação de quais são as vontades de quem está lá fora e não só as vontades dos programadores que estão cá dentro.
Acho que todos deixamos, no fundo, questões e perguntas importantes que devem ser voltadas a ser perguntadas ou respondidas aqui dentro da Fundação.
Realmente nós não conseguimos programar, nós não conseguimos dizer nada se não soubermos o que está pelo outro lado que nós nunca vimos. E isso torna uma instituição, isso torna uma programação acessível quando nós temos na nossa mesa várias perspectivas do que está a acontecer no mundo.
Num projeto que coloca, no fundo, o público no centro da equação, e não no sentido do público como destinatário, mas do público também como decisor, de alguma forma, alguém que tem voz e que tem poder para tomar decisões e para propor, as instituições têm que conseguir criar espaços de flexibilidade no sentido em que a zona de negociação é muito maior.
Quando eu refiro que é algo novo, é um sinal que talvez a Fundação possa assumir que o risco, que a necessidade de risco é um fator fundamental para essa mudança que tanto queremos.
E a instituição que estamos a invadir, reformar, reconstruir, recontar, refazer, recriar, dar voz e corpo, ser voz e corpo. Queremos programar uma osmose crítica. E aqui acaba o poema.
So, as you probably noticed, this was a project that combined several different departments at the Gulbenkian Foundation. The Gulbenkian Foundation is a very big organization with many different cultural assets. And it has a music department with a whole programming on music. And it has also a building and a garden, which is classified as heritage. And so it is worked also as an audience development plan. And then it has two museums, two really big collections. And so we needed a wider team. And that's why this project combined people from all these departments and also the marketing and the communication. And our prototype was actually engaging one of the audiences we realized that was the most absent audience in our programming, the youngsters, which is common to many cultural institutions that I know. And so we just decided that this could be our target group to test and to prototype. So after all the workshops we've done with our national partners, so Mapa das Ideias, we came out with this idea of developing a plan to work in a peer-to-peer way with the younger audiences. So one of the goals of these was, how could we program for and with the youngsters, and how can we engage them in the whole process of deciding things, you know, making decisions and sharing the communication process, the production processes, and the programming process. So it was crucial to listen, to debate, and to learn with each other, and also to create a participatory and collaborative methodology. So we just created four major phases. So the first one was to listen. And that's when we all gathered all these youngsters that came to us by open call. So we wanted a very diverse group so we could listen to people that usually wouldn't listen to, and listening together. And in order to do that, inviting not only people from within the organization, because the change makers, although we were all in the process, we wanted to contaminate the rest of the organization. So we also invited people from the other departments to come in, step in and engage with youngsters. But we also invited people from out there, from other cultural institutions, just in order to listen the more we could, not only to the youngsters, but also to the organization we were in, but also the cultural field around us. And then ideate and think, what would happen if I'm now in the role of a programmer? What would it be possible? What would I like to see in the future? And then create the moment to launch and test all the programming. And in order to do, you know, the learning of this, then have time to reflect and debate what happened and how does it make us change in the future. This is a process of change anyway. As you saw, the pandemic just hit us really hard. And it was exactly in the moment where we were, you know, beginning to make real everything that was being decided, and all the youngsters have decided a whole programming, a very ambitious one. We had decided that we would go on their ideas and taking all the risks, because as you saw, programming was seen by the whole group and by this audience as a way of making a stand in the world and just saying what is important to us as a generation, as a person, what is crucial for the future. So the pandemic came in a moment where we were beginning to make it real. And so it was really crucial to stop, pause, reassemble, and think, what is this about? And this was about change. Actually, the whole process was about change. Change within, change out there, change within us as an organization, but also as individuals. And so it was very interesting to see that the prototype we created and the methodology we were following with the Adeste Plus ACID really created a very flexible approach to programming or to whatever prototype we were trying to create. And this open structure was what enabled us to deal with something that we were not expecting. and to have the flexibility to adapt and to listen more, even more carefully than we were doing. And that's how we came up with another way of testing what we wanted to test, which was if we design programming altogether, if these youngsters take the role of the programmer inside this institution, what would happen? And actually, this was possible. Of course, the program was less ambitious than the first one, but it was ambitious enough to make us think and reflect on what could happen when we change the roles, what could happen when change happens. And it also helped us learning with the process, because even with all these changes, even with this transformation of a big program with everything, you know, live and sound and concerts and, you know, guest artists, and then just make it into a very small version of this with online conversations. But even this change didn't stop the reasoning behind the project, which was what happened when we work together with the target audience we want to work with. When we change roles, swap roles, but also when we share the stage, when we share the decision-making process. And by doing that, we learned that probably this will be true for all audiences, but for this audience particularly, it was a statement, nothing for or about the young without the young. And the reason I say this probably will work for all audiences is what Alessandra said in the beginning. We work on stereotypes most of the time. And we talk on behalf of people. We make decisions on behalf of people. And it's quite interesting when we incorporate all these people in the decision-making process and when we listen carefully. Then the other thing was think together and act together. So don't use this only to as a consultation, as a champions group. Just work together, act together. Give us the stage and share the stage. Then the listening process, it was, again, another outcome of these, because although we were aware that listening was important, listening in all these levels, just, you know, in the small group, then in the wider group, then within the organization, then outside the organization, just made us realize that the more we listen, the more we were able to learn and to change. Then the other one was the participatory processes and methodologies are really crucial if we want to listen and work together. And this has to be more in the center of any institution that is audience-centered and focused. The keywords that the youngsters highlighted throughout all the process were openness and dialogue and informality and proximity, which is quite interesting for such organizations like Gulbenkian Foundation, which are really big organizations and usually perceived as being really serious, very formal, and so very distant. In order to incorporate other audiences, we also had to change the way we approach even the work atmosphere and the work politics. To program is to intervene in society. And this was another thing that was said several times throughout the whole process that was actually one of the major demands that these audiences made to us. And so we should take more risks. We should be aware that what is happening around us, what is happening in the world, and be relevant in the now, the here and now, thinking about the future. And then again, some key words that were really important for us. Identity, for this group, identity issues were the thing to discuss, and we shouldn't avoid difficult or uncomfortable themes. Sustainability, critical thinking, decolonization of the narratives, changing the point of view, equality and equity, and visibility to the stories that usually are untold. So with this, I would say that this was a way of testing and prototyping and make real all the structure of this ACID methodology, but it was also a way of trying to create a new matrix for the future. And I must say that we are currently planning for next year to embed all this learning into a programming that could be a regular programming and no longer only prototype or tests for a younger programming in this same model. So incorporating youngsters in the decision-making process and working with them in order to create a peer-to-peer program that could last at least for the next 3 years and then learn with the process. Thank you. I don't know if we are already ready for the questions.
Yes, thank you so much, Susanna and Alessandra, Ines. If you both want to come back on screen, we'd be happy to open up the Q&A session. But firstly, thank you all so much for this great presentation and the examples of the program, you know, in action. This is great to see. I wanted to start with a question or two of my own, actually. Ines, you had this diagram up of, you know, where it's starting from the preparatory phase to the embedding phase. And actually, Susanna, you can probably answer this as well. I'm wondering if there are certain points between those where you find that organizations most often have a stumbling block, or if it's just completely different for everyone.
Well, let's say that the shared thing is that everybody does find, let's say, those steps. I mean, of course, when you see the results that our institution, our partners achieved, especially when you see a project like Imagina, which ambition was really high and actually up to the ambition, you might think that everything is easy, but it's not. Actually, every step, I mean, this is a step process, step-by-step process, but every step somehow brings you back to the usual issues. So all the time, in each step, you have to renegotiate. What is this? Why we are doing, are we letting them in really, why they're not listening and others are in. So it's because the main thing, the main, let's say, feature of the design thinking that we fell in love with, although, I mean, it's a tool, no? And it's a design tool everybody's using in many different contexts, it's not as such, but is that it's a reflective process and it's a relational process. So these two levels were absolutely key. And this means that all those steps and difficulties happen all along the way. I don't know, Ines and Susanna, if you agree, but I think that that's it's an answer, but it's not an easy one.
Yeah, and I would add that, well, of course, you're just listening to this case, but among the artistic partners in Adeste, there are so many different situations that that would just make the point for this question. You know, we all stepped in different ways. We all had to, you know, go back to the beginning so many times throughout the process, but we all ended up with some change and some really good reflection. I think the hard part, I must say, and still is the embed thing, you know, as we all know, you know, you test things, you create a project and you learn from the mistakes, you learn from the successes, but then make it last and make it really important as a changing tool. That's the hard part. And I'm really glad that we are going on this.
Absolutely.
It's a different model of working. Because in a certain sense, it's not a normal, because you let a foreign organization in this case, Gulbenkian let MAPA in, and all the other partners went through that process. So we are the strange element. But the goal is not for the strange element to tell you, like in a top-bottom perspective in a consultancy project, what's wrong with you and what you want to do. But the goal is that we're the strange ingredients is going to shake the waters and put that collective intelligence that's within the organization working. So that's the challenge. And of course, as Alessandra and Susanna were saying, it's all about acknowledging that there are barriers, that things are very difficult, but we're in this together, and that's a very important thing.
If I may answer to the question I see about how to implement the given the blocking forces, and also it is also the story of the connector, so which was the entry point. Actually, we looked for cultural institutions ready to do that. So this was, let's say, the legacy of an unsuccessful attempt we did the year before, 2017. And already then, the former director of the museum in Gulbenkian was quite interested in setting up something like that. But the complexity of organizations is quite layered. So 300 employees is not 30 employees, and it's not 5 employees. And we had more or less, in our institutions were, but we also tested with a voluntary community art-based center in Saragossa, for example. So you had really the span, or the opera theater in Rijeka. So with many different levels and layers. The entry point was us. That's true, they are blocking, but we think that there are plenty of people within cultural organizations really keen to do that. Maybe they are not in the board of directors, sometimes they are. In one case, we had the director taking part in all the stages of the process, all the stages, all the workshop, all the employees, and the director always there. Sometimes this happens, and sometimes not. We are now delivering a model, so the prototype is now become a blueprint, and it is available on the website. It will be available on a dedicated website with the tools, the steps, and whatever, but of course, change doesn't happen because we have a tool. But if you want the change happen, you need tools. So it's negotiating. Not everybody was completely aware of that kind of challenge as an organization when they stepped in. There was someone really keen to, and someone else really that was just thinking, it's just another audience development project. Let's try that. It's a European project, let's do. But without that understanding of the real implications. And of course, this also changes in terms of results. So our strategy is keep doing this, because in 10 years of long-lasting cooperation projects, working on these kind of things, we will push it forward. But there are already many, many people, really many people across Europe, professionals really into the topic. So we are not just a few ones, avant-garde. We are many, luckily.
Nice, that's great. I also love, Inesh, what you said earlier about having, the foreign element involved. I think, that is going to require so much trust and vulnerability. I would say that we're also lucky within our sector, though, that we do have such this communal aspect that we do want to support each other. And so it's always great to be able to see that in action. I think this is bouncing off a bit of what you were already just discussing, Alessandra, but there's certainly quite a few questions just on the initial point of the project in terms of, which channels are used to reach out to potential participants and whatnot. So just the technical aspects of, implementing this and getting involved. Could you discuss that a little more?
Do you want... for the project or just for the Adeste as a whole?
I think for your project, Susanna.
Yes, for me. Yeah, because I looked at there were some really particular questions. Okay, so as you probably noticed, the getting into the prototype was part of a set of 7 capacity workshops we had with MAPA. And that's really important just to mention this, because these capacity workshops are the ones who create a team. And as you notice, we were from different departments. So one of the most important things to begin with was to align the whole team and just get kind of a common ground. Because although we all work in the same cultural institution, we all deal with completely different kinds of programming. We set this programming to different kinds of audiences, and our priorities sometimes are very different, although we think they are the same. So just having the opportunity of being together, you know, in seven workshops, just with this aim of getting together, find common ground, and then decide what would it be if we could decide on a prototype to try on something that we really want to try and maybe we never did. And so this was the beginning. Then there is another beginning. So we get to this, and then we have to make this being approved by the board, because I'm not forgetting what you were asking, but there was another question about these blocking forces. They could be blocking or they could not be blocking. It depends on the way then you have this in the structure. So by being so many people from different departments, actually that made it much more easy to go up and just make the whole institution get along with what we were proposing. Because suddenly this was not the idea of one department or the museum or the education department, but something that we wanted to try out through different people in different perspectives that could cross, you know, into different departments and made us better equipped and better prepared to deal with other audiences in the future. And this was seen as something really good. Very positive point. So one of the things is, as Ines said and Alessandra, having the directors involved somehow, it's really good because then they are very supportive. So one of the things was the first prototype was pitched. We made the pitch for all the directors involved because there were so many. So we made sure that when we made the decision of, okay, now we go out there and going to find our youngsters, this was already supported by everyone that made decisions inside the institution and took to the board. It happened the same in the end. So when we had the final result, we created this video, we had all these findings on the project. We took it to the board again. We just made a special presentation for all members of the board and all the other directors involved, so people were aware of what happened. And I must say that this is the reason why we will be able to trade again in the near future. So never forget that there, you know, all the structure needs to feel that this is really important. It doesn't matter if it comes from up, down, or down, or down to the bottom. Then the other part that was asked was, how did we find these youngsters and how we decided this? So the Gulbenkian Foundation, as I told you, is a very important, it's a very big institution and it's very well known in Portugal, but it has no resonance in the youngsters culture. To tell the truth, the Gulbenkian Foundation, because it's made its way by being a kind of a ministry of culture during a lot of time, not nowadays, but, and so it's really crucial and important, relevant for another generation, not the younger generation. The younger generation is already born in a completely different country with a lot of other cultural institutions, with a lot of programming, you know, happening everywhere. So Gulbenkian Foundation wouldn't be the first place for these youngsters to come. So we were very aware of this, and we knew that if we just made a regular open call in the website of the Gulbenkian Foundation or the Facebook or the social media of the Gulbenkian, we only would get the few youngsters that identify themselves already in the institution. And we didn't want to find these ones. We wanted to have the other ones. The ones who would tell us, well, I would never go unless you change something, because otherwise they would come. So in order to do this, again, we went to different departments in the Gulbenkian Foundation that work in completely different projects, that work in the neighborhoods or with, you know, associations, with ONGs, so other kind of people. And we asked for help to create a network of contacts that would help us reach people that in another way we wouldn't reach. And it was through these that we made the open call. So first we contacted people on ONGs or associations that we knew that had a connection to a certain location or space in Lisbon and surroundings, just to make sure that they understood what we were asking for. Then we helped, we asked for help for them to spread the word. And that's how we got our 21 youngsters. Actually, we got 30. We were looking for 21. And I just share this with you because sometimes it's in the tiny details that our stereotypes show up. When we had to select, because we had too many applicants and too few places, then we had to make a selection. And we just asked for very simple things. So it could be, you know, three paragraphs about why do I want to be part of this. It could be three photos or images, or it could be a video with 3 minutes at the most. And people just chose different ways. And suddenly, the people that sent photos didn't write anything. Well, we didn't ask for that. And we got ourselves into a position that we were making decisions and we were giving priority to the people that explained very clearly why they were going to come. And then suddenly, someone in the middle of this said, we're doing this all wrong again, because we are, again, using the stereotype of, you know, the ones who can write very well are the ones who are going to pick. So what about the other ones that shows a completely different way? These are the ones we want to listen, because these are the ones that usually don't show up. So we just changed it again, and we ended up with a very, very diverse group, which was really important. Most of these people had never come before to Gulbenkian, and that was important. Well, the other thing is another question that was there. So all we did in the beginning, so because of that, because we knew that a lot of these people had no connection to the Gulbenkian, maybe only with the name and the symbolic statues, but not the real thing, the first moment was also to connect with the institution, because they were going to program not for another place, but for this particular institution. And you need to be aware of the constraints and the possibilities that this open. And so, They participated in most of the cultural events that were happening at the time, so they get an idea of what was the actual programming we had. They contacted with all the programmers inside the institution, the stage director, and everyone connected to, you know, putting up out there some cultural offer for any kind of audience. And then we invited people from other institutions. And this was the time where they made the first decisions, because they were the ones who picked up the other programmers they wanted to talk to. So we could have a kind of a round table of discussion about programming. I guess I answered all the questions as well.
Oh, Susanna, thank you so much for that. I mean, I think also this anecdote about the selection process is interesting, because I mean, you had to start the new listening phase very early on, and you know, also what you said before that too about, you know, involving the whole organization. We hear a lot about how important it is to be, you know, holistic, and the whole organization should be involved when taking these risks. But I think one of the things you pointed out about not only are you getting, you know, the best ideas that way, but also you have more mobility that way, kind of addressing those blocking forces. I think that's certainly important to keep in mind. If you all have time, I would take at least a couple more questions from the chat, if that's fine. Inesh, this is directly to you, actually. If an institution would like to implement this strategy, would MAPA be able to accompany and tutor this methodology?
I actually answered Philippa by writing. Oh, yes, of course.
Sorry.
All the partners of the Adeste Plus project are willing and available for the implementation or the dissemination of the methodology. But we will also have the blueprint as an open source on a website until the end of the year. So the idea is that you can go both ways, even though that we recognize that the presence of the strange ingredient is important for the implementation of the methodology. But our goal as a team is to have it as an open resource for anybody. But of course, MAPA is more than available and very interested in that, of course. Thank you.
That's great. Thank you so much. And then here as well, not so much a question, but more of a reflection. It says here, thank you so much for these inspirations. I think this process could especially help on one of the biggest challenges and changes for society and our institutions, and that is to address climate action. And I'm wondering, especially, with bringing youngsters in, as was done, Susanna, I'm wondering if this conversation came into play, perhaps also due to everything going online, due to the pandemic, if that came up at all.
Yeah, that was one of the subjects that I really wanted to make sure that we would address. And for instance, for the roundtables that you saw online, they chose particularly people that were connected to this climate strike, so they would have this voice present as a discussion. And they were demanding, as in most of the other subjects, but they were demanding that cultural institutions also made a stand and just take a position in these really crucial matters. So that's something that we learned. And for instance, next year, one of the major themes we're going to work as an not only with these youngsters, I'm hoping, but as the Modern Arts Center, it will be actually connected to ecology and all this climate change, because I think museums have to be aware that we need to address in an artistic form, but we need to address the current issues that are really concerning us, not only now as a generation, but also in the future. Actually, the Gulbenkian, this isn't just another thing, which is maybe something that we forget. Institutions have most of the times a mission and a mission statement. And for us, it was also very important, and that was the way we got to be supported, is that we knew that we were addressing very clearly all the mission that was behind the foundation role in Portuguese society. And we even made sure that we were able to connect to other departments that were out of this project, just because we knew that one of the strategic lines for the last few years was going and work with the younger generations in all departments. So we knew that we were just choosing also a target audience that was at the center of our strategic plan. And that makes it more relevant for the institution. And sometimes that's a way to make it easier, in all the process.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, finding a way to really honor your mission statement, but still, be able to develop and move forward, and also tackle some of these, really difficult and pressing discussions and challenges for society. It's a lot for a cultural institution to take on. And, I think that's why programs such as this, where we can lean on each other and learn from each other, are so valuable. Yeah, I mean, I think we could continue with this for quite some time, but we're already, I think, 10 minutes over our time. So unless any one of you has a final statement that they'd like to share, then I think we would close for the day. Well, thank you so much. Thank you all for being here. Thank you to Adeste Plus all around. And yeah. Wishing you all a pleasant rest of your afternoon then.
Thank you so much. Bye.
Thank you.
Anyway.